Okay. I don't know what Mark said, but let's see. The title is Agency and Media Under the Shadow of the Avant Garde. Now, the thought was different initially, actually, but anyway, we'll fix it together. Now, I will try to do this in 5 steps, okay? I will try initially to clarify the definition. Then I will do a historical analysis, hopefully not historicist that you would like, but a sociologist always needs history to ground himself somehow or herself. Then we'll go back to 68, which is a vantage point for the discussion, with 2 theoretical discussions, Chomsky and Foucault, Dubord and McLuhan. And then we again will traverse history into the 90s, and then we'll come to Cyprus, inevitably. We'll see what the relation of Cyprus with Chiapas may be, and we will end up with the Avant Garde, which we will be meeting along, and the concept of the affinity group. Now, let's start with Marx, okay? Now, Marx said, man, humans, make their history, but not under conditions of their own choice. Thereby we have 2 things, right? We have the environment, and then we have the human being who is trying to do something. Agency, and as far as the environment, the focus here will be on the media. And the reason we'll focus on the media is not only my vantage point teaching, I'm teaching cultural studies and media, it's also, I would suggest, that the key technological revolution of the present has to do with communication, plus everything else. But communication is the key thing which, if Marx had to talk, I would suggest, don't get us, about the productive forces of today, he would probably focus on the ability, on the technologies enabling us to communicate or to not communicate between us. Now, as far as the agency now, the agency, I will take the left as the agency. Now, the left is a multiple thing, right? I mean, we may start from the English Revolution, but the heroic birth moment of the left is the French Revolution, okay? It's a historic moment, it's a rupture, a little bit of a fantastic rupture, but anyway, it's a rupture in which finally and for the first time the equality of all human beings is proclaimed and codified in a constitution. So the left, however, has changed forms. So the first question which we have to answer with a brief historical reference is, what keeps together this thing called the left? I mean, leftists have been killing themselves, if we see them historically, for several reasons. I mean, the liberals and the socialists have been at each other's throat. The nationalists have been actually at some point leftists also. So we have to explore this thing, not to remind you of 68 when the Communist Party was closing the factory doors to the revolutionary students, right? The left is fighting itself. But there must be something unifying there. And then there is the next question, which you have to explore, if there is one modernity on this planet, or many. That's when we come to say. Let's take the historical narrative now. I would suggest that the key thing characterizing all leftist movements is what Alexis de Tocqueville called the irreversible force of equality. All the leftist movements have been, in one way or another, promoting this novel idea that all human beings are born equal. This is a novel idea, historically in civilizations, okay? Now, I remind you that Aristotle couldn't really figure out what the slave is, if he's a human being or something else, an object, okay? So finally we have this. Albert Camus also added a little appendix to the story and said, not only we have this principle of equality running through history, but we have entered a moment which is not sacred. For the first time, human beings have to justify what they are doing on the basis of their own values. They cannot invoke something higher, God, okay. So the first, therefore, in this context, left, is a democratic liberal left. It's the left which claims equality in the realm of the political sphere. We may say that this, the nationalists were part of this. The nationalists may have ended up producing monsters, but in their initial moments, they were claiming all the people of the nation are equal, somehow. Okay, not the nation are not equal, but it's okay. Now, this movement goes until 1848. 1848 is a key moment. There is a new revolutionary upset in the whole of Europe. Actually, it's the first time we have this pan-European uprising, which happens to coincide with print media. This is the time, actually, that the newspapers are printed on a daily basis in many European countries, and actually the uprisings which spread from France to Austro-Hungarian Empire, etc., are actually reproducible due to the newspapers. Let me remind you that 1968 is the rebellion of the television. The whole world is watching, okay? Chicago, 1968. So, keep that in mind as we march on. Now, in 1848, however, apart from Marx writing the manifesto, we have also a very interesting moment. The working class appearing at the end of the uprisings, at least in France, with the June uprising. It's crushed, of course, but the working class for the first time enters the scene. The working class movement itself will constitute itself as a historical subject after the 1870s. The commune is its moment of martyrdom, etc. But the working class movements which will emerge in Europe are diverse, even though they share two very fundamental characteristics. One, the principle of equality is spreading from the political to the economic sphere. Secondly, the whole idea of the sovereign individual, which was necessary for the democratic liberal revolution so that the rights of individuals will be respected in constitution, etc., is questioned. As Weber said, he's not left, but he's useful here. It's a mockery of the intellect to claim that there is equality of opportunity if somebody has equal rights, but somebody is rich and another one is poor. So the working class, for the first time, raises the issue again of collectivity. Collectivity has been the way human beings constituted themselves throughout the centuries, whether it was the village, whether it was religion, whether it was whatever. So the working class is putting again on the agenda that issue. 1917, the Bolshevik Revolution, is the triumphant moment. It's the second spreading of the principle of equality from the political realm to the economic realm. But at that moment, in those 20, 30 years, that's also another rupture, the modernist rupture, the Avant Garde, at least in its classical form. From Cubism to Futurism, Futurism is peculiarly significant, I think, in this case, and climaxing in Surrealism. Now, why is the modernist Avant Garde moment significant in this narrative of the left? The modernists were not essentially leftists. Let's be clear about this, at least my reading, that's what it says. I mean, take Futurism, right? Marinetti will become a fascist, Mayakovsky will become a Bolshevik, as clear as it can be, right? It's only the Surrealists, actually, because they have a Lenin or Stalin under Breton who are consistent in their position, okay? Before the revolution, actually, before Dada, there are left-wing and right-wing. So why and how can we say that modernism is, in a way, a part of this long march of the left? Because now, let's add another concept. Apart from inequality hierarchy, hierarchy itself implies culture, implies, as Dumont said in analyzing the Indian system, a holistic understanding, a culture which not only convinces, is internalized by human beings to believe that they belong to a certain stage, etc. So if you are going to subvert this hierarchy in order to create what Camus said, the non-sacred moment in human history, you have to smash the whole. That's what modernism did. In many ways, I'm not an expert on modernism. I teach only cultural studies, right? But my understanding of modernism is that it breaks down the totality that was inherited through the ages. It decomposes the image. If Western painting had reached the 19th century to perfect the image, the 20th century modernism, well, from the Impressionist actually onwards, the image will be deconstructed, decomposed, and reconstructed. The message is clear. There is nothing sacred. As a matter of fact, we can create everything. We can destroy and reconstruct everything. There is no sacred in this century. In that sense, Breton is right. Surrealism as the climax of modernism claims a revolution analogous to the revolution already happening in the Soviet Union. He is also correct in sensing that the revolution in the Soviet Union cannot and is not fulfilling, at least, his understanding of what a cultural revolution should be. Parenthesis. We have to be realistic. Okay? I mean, if in a country where people living in cities were maximum 20%, and you have to make a revolution of a proletariat, and these people were deeply religious, you can send trains around showing them films. You can educate them. But you cannot convince them really that Mayakovsky is the best poet. You have in some way to build on their own culture. So whether we like it or not, the surrealist rupture, the modernist avant-garde rupture, could be introduced by Eisenstein, could be added by the modernists of the 1920s, but ultimately, if you follow Eisenstein, you will see that from the Potemkin or October to Alexander Nevsky, we have a shift from the people as the hero to the individual leader as the hero. So there is a shift even in Soviet modernism in that sense towards the necessity of building what Stalin said, whatever. I'm an anarchist, but I'm saying what reality was happening there. So, since I opened this small discussion about Mr. Stalin and the anarchists, let me make a first differentiation. Okay. 1936, Spanish Revolution. Now, the Spanish anarchists are a very interesting phenomenon. We remember them when we read Chiapas and Silence. They are not educated, they are not intellectuals. They are a grassroots movement. It's a vast trade union movement based on anarchist principles of self-rule. It has to do with the local culture, of course, but it's based on that. Now, these people, they have the trade union, but the anarchist organization, the counterpart of the Communist Party, is semi-legal. So they are organizing what they call affinity groups. Small groups of ideological comrades, friends, no hierarchical organization. Chomsky, if you're following him, he's actually painting a picture of some of the Islamic groups is the same thing. They don't have a leader. They have small groups. So, in Paris, we have the Avant Garde. Let me give you an example to see the picture. In Paris, of the Avant Garde, free love means having multiple erotic partners. In Casas Viejas, small town in southern Spain, in which the local anarchists were the majority in the region, stage a revolution, as they understand it, for libertarian communism before the revolution, and they are crushed. They have a long tradition, for decades actually, of having an anarchist tradition among the poor, etc. There, the concept of free love meant what? What did you imagine it meant? It meant marrying at the trade union building, not the church. The free love concept was you marry because of romantic love, not because your parents tell you to marry, and you refuse to marry at the church or the municipal building of the state, and you go to the trade union, the Senate, to marry. So already we have strangely different modernities here, okay? They are there. The poor people of Casas Viejas, they have a libertarian vision, which in 1968 would have been understandable. But in their time, they couldn't even figure out that if they had a revolution, they had to coordinate with others and not stage a revolution in their region, and then the army comes and crushes them. Okay, just to keep the balance. Anyway, 1945, when the red flag is raised over the Reichstag, and the American flag, remember the Americans anyway, were born out of the revolution anyway, is the triumph of the French Revolution, the real triumph. In 1945, the last remnant of the ancient regime, the belief that human beings are higher and lower, etc., is killed, is dead, gone. You may say, yes, but fascism is coming back. Nobody dares to talk about superior and inferior human beings nowadays. Even the fascists in Europe will say, no, 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 we want to protect our nation. We don't want the others. But in 1945, we still had the belief that some people were higher, some people were lower. There it goes. After 1945, the principle of equality is established and the avant-garde becomes established as the hegemonic culture in the academy. Is it bad to be co-opted, revolutionary speaking? Yes. Historically, sociologically speaking, it's inevitable. You cannot change the world otherwise. In other words, you have to embed the ideas into the forms which exist, unless there is some way to have a birth out of virginity or something. In other words, but as I'm trying to argue here, if there are four social spheres, already the principle of equality has rammed through the political and the economic sphere, and we have a crisis in the cultural sphere. Human beings adopt ideas slowly. Of course, during the moment of revolution, the people who participate, they have a vision of the future. As Hannah Arendt says, it's almost like people are intoxicated with a great drinking session, okay? But then they wake up and they have a hangover, okay? So in one way or another, co-optation creates hegemony and creates the next stage of revolt. The next stage of revolt is 1968. In 1968, this long revolution which goes through different social spheres erupts in the realm of everydayness. And when it erupts there, it doesn't erupt only, until then, difference was vertical. It was actually the conservatives who claimed difference. They claimed that all human beings are different because some people are superior. In 1968, for the first time, difference was horizontal. Somebody said, I'm gay, you have to respect me. I don't want to be superior, I don't want to be inferior. I'm just different, okay? Women, I am a person and I'm not a man, and I'm different and I'm equal. I'm black, I'm not white, I don't want to be white. And I have to be respected as different on a horizontal basis. In that sense, however, the very foundation of human identity goes into crisis. And we are still living, I would argue, with that moment. In other words, human beings, the conflicts which we have been seeing for the last 200 years have been getting into the very deep psychological state of the person. In other words, human beings have to construct new identities, and that's not easy. I mean, think of it from 68 nowadays. How many years now? 60? No, 50. 50 years, right? Now, 50 years. We are not really sure what a male and a female is, right? Right, we are not. It's, I mean, you may say, I want to be called a man, right? I may say, I want to be called a woman. And I have the right, actually. I may even want to have, I mean, it's weird. You have the genitals of a woman, but you can call a man. I have the genitals of a male, right? So, gays are respectably accepted, right? So, racism is considered totally bad. If you're an academic and you write something racist, they will disqualify you from going to Congress. Stalin is one of the leaders now, right? Whatever, but that's what happens, right? So here we are. The revolution, in some sense, as Raoul Vanegem says, has entered the realm of everydayness. There is something which is not as cheerful as he portrayed it, because the right wing also reacts there. The American nativist said, I want my country. I have nothing against the blacks. I have nothing against anybody. I want my country. I want my identity. And that's what nationalists say around the world. So when the character identity collapses, then all the ups and downs that were internalized have to be dealt with and redefined. Okay. So in 1968, so in order to understand this, let's impose for a moment. How much time do I have? No. Time, anyway. Then we're going to say. Limon, in the aftermath of 68, I remind you, May 1968, was not only French, it was global. And in that global, we have to include also the Red Guards of China. Even if you don't like Maoism, that was part of it, okay? And Godard was influenced to make a film. In America, the Cultural Revolution was inspired. And remember that while we have been talking so far about what was happening in Europe, the whole world was experiencing another revolution, which was held by the Russian Revolution, decolonization. For the first time, the West did something positive. It unified the planet, but it did it in a river of blood. Okay? It conquered the world in the most ruthless way. So that thing collapsed. The principle of equality, in the sense, started spreading globally. And 68 was not only a Western event. 68 was a global event. But let's hang on with 68. I think 69 or something, a Danish radio calls Foucault and Chomsky for a discussion. Now, there are two dimensions in their discussion which are interesting to understand this strange world which was born out of this collapsing world of culture and this diffusion in everydayness of the looking for new identities. The first is, do we have a human nature? Why is it significant to know if we have a human nature? Because the question is, how are we going to make a revolution? Marx solved the problem, sort of, by saying we have one fundamental nature, okay? We create the world. So our work is defining us by creating the world. Okay, we are alienated, but still at least we have something we can get back. Chomsky goes a step further back. He's more Kantian and says, no, no, we have a basic internal structure, language. Our ability to compose thoughts out of a minimum amount of internalized codes implies that we have a universal human nature. I don't know if he's right. What I know is that this is one of the leading intellectuals of our left nowadays, and this is accepted. Habermas picked it up and made it part of his whole theory. Therefore, the left suddenly feels, we didn't have this concern before, feels that we have to talk about communication. This is part of us, okay? Now, on the other hand is Foucault. Foucault says, no way, we don't have nature. Everything is constructed. Not only everything is constructed by power. So therefore, every form of identity, we should be suspicious of. Only in the resistance to the force of power can we kind of find residuals which could claim as freedom. So, question number one. Now we have one who is claiming, hey, well, at least we have something that we can all agree, the ability to communicate, language. The other one says, no, we don't have anything in common. We are shaped by society and we are shaped by power. Part number two. Okay, how do we change society? Foucault, European, very clear. Smash the state. There's no other way. Smash power, smash, general. Foucault, no, we have been building for two centuries realms of freedom. We have gained democracy, we have to extend it. We have to conduct, let's say, civil disobedience, so we have the expansion of freedom. You may say, wait. The one is an anarchist and he wants reform, the other is supposedly a radical, which is not Marxist, but he wants to smash the system. Yes, but what happens here is actually very understandable. Chomsky is following the classical anarchist tradition of Kropotkin. He's saying that, as a matter of fact, human beings are expanding the areas, realms of freedom. The other one says we should be suspicious of everything that was given to us by power. We should go back to it. So what's the answer? We don't know. As a matter of fact, we have been fighting for 50 years about this one. At the same time, and there we come to the communication issue. Ah, that was it. What's your emotion? Sorry. Anybody who has a... Oh no, anyway, la libro. Ama minum pende lepta pe, muy ana... Libo. Now.
10 minutes.
Mira, mo deka lepta. 20 minutes. Ένιωνα προλάβω, ένα μικρός. Ωραία. Ως που προλάβω. Μετά λίγο μας σταματήσω. Το λοιπόν, Dubord and McLuhan. Dubord, maybe the last great representative of the avant-garde who renegades on the avant-garde. And he says, applying Lukács' reading of Marx, of early Marx, that what has happened in modern societies, modern still, is the following. The realm of production has moved away from the factory into everyday life. And what is really being produced is meaning, is life itself. And the really exploitative mechanism, he doesn't care much about the media, but he cares about the result of the media, which is the spectacle. The spectacle is the condensed form of human alienation. So if beforehand we had to smash the state somehow and reshape it, and we had to abolish capitalism and collectivize everything, now we are confronted with a more complicated issue, right? I mean, here we have to understand somebody stealing the meaning of our lives and creating soap operas and selling them back to us, and they're buying advertisements, and we don't know, I mean, how can we organize people now to rebel against that? I mean, complicated. But he has been proven amazingly foreshadowing, right? I mean, the concept society of the spectacle has become more popular than anything else, culture, industry, or other related terms. Okay, so Gideon is right. What has been happening in the last years, especially with technological developments, is that human beings are craving to have their 15 minutes of publicity, as Andy Warhol said. And somehow they are selling themselves. Think of reality shows. They go up there, they pour out their souls, and the whole goal is that the TV station will get more advertisements. They're selling life. There's something strange, however, right? We don't know how to make this proletariat, this alienated proletariat of everydayness rebellious. Other side, same period in the United States, Marshall McLuhan has another theory. Folks, McLuhan says, we have to understand that something is happening before our eyes and we don't see it. We are extending the body. The wheel is an extending of the leg. The telephone is an extension of the ear. As a matter of fact, technologies of communication are extensions of the body. And, lo and behold, as a matter of fact, the new technology, electronic technology, is liberatory, emancipatory. It's actually a technology which has all the good traits which the initial tribal societies had with the technology of the present. You may say, fantasies, psychological fantasies, blah, blah, blah. No. As a matter of fact, Marshall McLuhan is based on a very materialist analysis of Harold Innes. Harold Innes, which is actually the inspiration of McLuhan's work, studied what Walter Benjamin also referred to. What are the media? What are the material bases of the media in the world? For example, when people write on stones, right? You couldn't carry stone. You couldn't just take the stone from Egypt and take it to Greece to read it and learn. They had to invent paper, so that communication will increase, right? And even then, we had to wait until printing machines so that human beings could communicate. When I came to Cyprus in the 1990s, I didn't even need to buy American magazines. I could get in the internet thing. Therefore, suddenly, technology and its material basis is right. Now, I have to convince you more of McLuhan, so I will just use another example in my 5 minutes remaining. McLuhan actually said, we don't watch television. McLuhan, by the way, was all for television. Okay? If you have read anything against television from McLuhan, they don't know what they're saying. McLuhan says, television is good because it's participatory. We don't see television, we touch it. No, stupid. No, what are you doing? What is everybody doing with their small telephones like that? Are we touching it? So, in some strange way, McLuhan was right. As a matter of fact, this technology is becoming very individualized and at the same time participatory. Whether it's good or bad, we don't know. So we have two theories now. The one is right, the spectacle. The other one is also right, it's participatory. We don't know how to manage this thing. Briefly, 90s, and if I manage, we get to Cyprus. If we don't manage, yeah. Now, so let's see what happens in the 90s. The 90s enter with the television as a huge airplane. It bombs Iraq, and Iraq cannot answer back, right? We see only the American CNN. As a matter of fact, the collapse of the Soviet Union, so naive, I mean, when you look back at the collapse of the Eastern Bloc, you think these people are amazingly naive. Think of the Chinese. Okay? I'm reminding you, I like the anarchists, I'm an anarchist, I'm not a Stalinist, but I'm telling you, if you are doing real politics, you have to be realistic. Okay. So the Chinese, what do they do? Gorbachev goes, students gather, blah, 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 I'm fine, blah, blah, blah. Gorbachev leaves, the students are there, CNN goes and parks there, and broadcasts to the whole of the world in China the image of China wants democracy, which means we want to subvert the Chinese regime, right? So the Chinese, they tell the students, please, are you going to leave? No. Please, are you going to leave? No. Okay. Cut, take CNN, get out of the country, they go, they pick the students and they leave. End of the story. Soviet Union. They have a referendum, 62% say we want socialism, Boris Yeltsin stages a counter-coup, and the whole country is collapsing. And there is nobody to resist. Okay. Why? So, the American media are amazingly effective. 1994, Chiapas, peasants, like that. Now, Marcos, weird guy. You never see his face, right? He goes among the peasants, backward, inside with Horkani. Okay? You are clever. He writes well, right? Why don't you go in Paris? Why don't you go in San Francisco? Why do you go to the stupid peasants? My teacher, Walt, he died now. He used to say, you know, I like Marcos. I understand you, you young generation of radicals, who you like to be invincible. But I mean, what is this culture from Chiapas? It's childish. He couldn't understand it, okay? But Marcos goes there, and that movement becomes global via the internet. So, for the first time, versus the television, we have the McLuhan-esque medium, which suddenly we can react. And then we have Yugoslavia, ha! And there, multiple modernities erupt on our table. Milosevic is authoritarian, but he's elected. He's not worse than Boris Yeltsin. He's actually better than Boris Yeltsin. Now, Kosovo is made up of Albanians who want autonomy or independence, whatever. Fair enough. I know I can make you a list of about 100 countries who have minorities who want autonomy. As a matter of fact, we have none in Cyprus, and we are complicated with this story, right? But anyway, the West decides that they are going to give the Kosovars independence. They bomb Kosovo. Then the people leave, and again, the American media and the Western media are amazing. While the people are bombed, and they leave normally, obviously, to avoid the bombing. Come on, in Cyprus, we left Famagusta. You know, there's a city, Famagusta. We left it because the Turkish army was approaching. So, in Kosovo, what happened? The same thing. Bombs were falling, people were leaving. But instead of blaming those who were bombing, we blame Milosevic. So, okay. The Western center-left, which came to power in 1997, was all for the bombing of Yugoslavia. East of the Danube, every leftist was against the bombing of Yugoslavia. Even people who disliked Milosevic, I disliked Milosevic on Bosnia. But on Kosovo, I was sure the Yugoslavs, the Serbians were right. It was amazingly manipulated. But why am I saying all these things? Because the Yugoslav war was the first time somebody used the internet against the Western communication machine. The Yugoslavs used it. So it was the same time that Seattle happened in Europe. And Seattle also used the mobilization in Seattle, used also the internet. So we are ushered into a new era. What does this tell us? It tells us that communication-wise, we have the technology to manipulate the people amazingly, amazingly. Look at now. Well, I was about to go into this anti-Russian hysteria, but it's okay. Let me come to Cyprus as a finishing touch, okay? Now, Marcos exemplifies the new radical identity. For in the new radical form, we don't really enshrine the individual anymore. As a matter of fact, the more the capitalist market wants to sell us stuff as individuals, academia, left, mainstream, or whatever, is crushing the concept of the individual. from the time of Ronald Barthes. We know that the individual is dead, as a matter of fact. It's language, Barthes says, which speaks to us. It's not like our invention. The genius who created has been kind of slightly pushed to the side, and it's disappearing altogether. So in that sense, the poor peasants of Marcos and his invisibility, and I remind you that Marcos is not only one, Banksy is another one, there are suddenly people who refuse to be proclaimed genius, who refuse to sign, who refuse to be heroes. And at the same time, all these people who are considered poor peasants in Guerra, they become parts of history in some way or another. So, when I come to Cyprus, I realize there is a paradox. I grew up speaking Cypriot. I never understood why in school we had to speak in Greek. It's okay. I learned English, I studied in the United States, I came back and I found this thing in front of me. In the late 90s, there was a very good study which found out the following. Cypriot by 90%, 95% spoke the Cypriot language, let me call it language, instead of dialect. Okay. Not only spoke it, they considered it part of their identity, but they considered it inferior. Now, how on earth can you consider inferior something that you insist on talking? If you consider it inferior, stop talking it. The Cretans have given up on it. All the other Greek origin languages have given up. They have been defeated by Athens. The Cypriots have been adamant about it. One of the people supporting the suppression of the Cypriot language said, the Cypriots are defending their dialect like Ajax, Aeandas. I mean, they are fighting tooth and nail not to give up their language. So how can you be fighting to defend your language and consider your language inferior? Cypriots, peasants, organ, Chiapas. In other words, we have multiple modernities here. There's one modernity which says, what happens in Paris, what happens in Athens, is the supreme, and we should adopt it. And the peasants say yes. One of the best books ever written about Cyprus nationalism is Imagining the Modern. What did it mean to become a Turk or a Greek? It meant that you will not be Horkagos. You will be Greek or Turk or Constantinople or Athens, right? Well, so far the Cypriots remain and they refuse. So you have split personalities. Second part, and I'm promising you I'm finishing. Now in Cyprus we have the most controlled media environment of Europe. Hungary is nothing in front of Cyprus. Five televisions are controlled by the president or five people in his surroundings, not even the rest of the area. Five Pan-Cyprian television stations. Of the newspapers, two are controlled by the government, radio stations accordingly, as television, etc. So, in this 90% control communication environment, tell me why we had the following two events. 2003, out of the negotiations of the Cyprus problem, suddenly they decide to open the borderline in Nicosia. The newspapers are clear. Don't go, it's not good. Yeah. You're not going to go to our houses as tourists. Blah, blah, blah. And suddenly in the April in Cyprus hot. You have these lines of people refusing to hear the radio, refusing to hear the television, refusing to hear the newspapers. They are there and they want to go. Now, that's an interesting stubborn resistance. It's like the resistance, you speak the language which you have been taught that is inferior. What has made the Cypriots go? In part, oral language. Remember that apart from print and television, in Cyprus, like all peasant societies, or the oral form of communication is still strong. Still, that was 2013. Okay, the economic crisis came to Cyprus, blah, blah, blah. Anastasiadis is elected, blah, blah. He goes to make a deal so that everybody's savings will be taxed, haircut, whatever, so that the customers of his lawyer's office will not have many losses. It's horrible, if you think of it. Because if that passes, every time the banks have a problem, they will be taking the savings of everybody, not only of the banks who have a problem, of every bank. And the minimum savings account, which is 100,000, will be abolished. The newspapers are like, even the leftist newspaper. Yeah. Hey, what can we do? Sorry. That was announced Friday. By Tuesday, not even the party of the government dared to vote for it. All the others voted against it, and the ruling party abstained. How come? There was such a huge furor in society. Okay, how did that furor? They were stupid. What did they come? Okay, it's weekend. It's the carnival weekend. It's the Green Monday. So the Cypriots will just, you know, go get drunk, etc. Wrong. In a half-peasant society mind, not in practicality, people talk. So they go to the carnival, they have their family feast, and the only thing they talk about is this thing. We have been cheated. So by Monday night, the message is clear to everyone, even to the ruling party. Everybody is furious, so they don't vote. So in some strange way, therefore, even in a controllable environment, if you don't control the main means of communication, resistance is possible, and actually in an unexpected way. What is the problem? There is no continuity. A year after 2003, in the plebiscite, a vast majority, almost the same majority which went there, voted no. Because unless you can build, there is no solution. Now, let me end up with the story of Avant Garde and Affinity Group. Avant Garde and Affinity Group have something in common. Small groups, limited in time, proclaiming something. The one is lower class, the other is upper class in the global system. The difference lies in the fact, however, that the avant-garde still is hierarchical. It's imagining that it's discovering one truth. The affinity group is more, that's why it related to Chiapas, is more pluralistic in that sense. I think I have to stop, but I can say that, for example, as an example, in Limassol, from the 1990s, trying to save the city from everybody who wanted to create either high buildings or parkings, etc., we created initiatives. The initiatives in Limassol had one basic characteristic. They were self-limited in time. In other words, you create one initiative, it mobilizes people, you don't ask them what they believe in anything else, and then you have general assemblies which, once they achieve something, they disappear. Sounds like guerrilla warfare, but it may be one of the remnants of the avant-garde in our age. I think I am within time, right? Okay, end of the story.
I've got a question. Okay.